Hi, everybody, and welcome back to the Shame Plays Out of the Abyss Notes series, where I DM a group of players through the Out of the Abyss D&D 5th Edition Underdark Adventure at my friendly local game store. Remember to support your friendly local game store. It's not just about product, it's also about community and Amazon and all that. No matter how great they are, cannot provide the community that a game store can, nor can they provide, I walk in and get it right then. So, you know, balance it out. The hobby would not be what it is without friendly local game stores. And enough of that. I mean, I occasionally buy stuff off Amazon too, but not exclusively. So anyway, this is just where I give my tips and thoughts and whatnot as I do this. And people seem to enjoy watching these videos. So whether you're a player, a DM, or whatever, I'm glad you're watching. Returning viewers, thank you. New viewers, I think you'll find it's a good mix of kind of helping understand how to play Out of the Abyss, but also just talking about D&D in general and thoughts on being a dungeon master and rules and whatnot. So this session went a little bit off the rails, probably the most off the rails that this group has gotten. It didn't get bad, but it could have. I tend not to get kind of off the rails, but, you know, every now and then, why not? And we did just a little bit this past Tuesday, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. It was a lot of fun. And there were some, like, wow, like, knuckle-biting moments that really caught me off guard. And actually, we had one thing that happened that was kind of epic, so I'll talk more about that later in the video. But we're in Blingdenstone. Doing all the adventures or the quests at this point around Blingdenstone, which is the Deep Gnomes for Neblum City, and we're right on the eve of the battle for Blingdenstone. It is basically where we're at. And last video, they had defeated the Basilisks in Entomox Moon, and Nomi Pathshutter was starting to play with the summoning circle that supposedly summons powerful elementals, and in fact does. So that's kind of where things had been left. Before we get into what happened in this most recent session, including a T-Rex attack, that's right, Tyrannosaurus Rex attack, let's do viewer mail. Let me put on my +3 glasses of viewer feedback. And we will take a look at the viewer feedback on YouTube. You can also email me if you want, shane@shaneplays.com. I still want your Rocktopus art. If somebody can do me a Rocktopus, I'll definitely show it in here. I think the Rocktopus is, like, super cool. But anyway, okay. Notes from last session. Here we go. First is from the Michael Metcalf. He says, "This question is as much for everyone as it is for Shane. But I'm just curious, in people's playthrough of Out of the Abyss, has anyone come across any NPC that resembles Lewis Carroll's characters from his beloved novel, Alice in Wonderland, or Through the Looking Glass? I know that Darrow Droki, and that's from Gracklestug, is a character strongly based off the White Rabbit, with him always running around, mumbling to himself, and just always out of sight from the players. I have viewed Ilvara as a Queen of Hearts type character with her obsession of hunting down the PCs out of spite. And the Myconids from Neverlight reminded me of the Talking Flowers, not to mention the theme of madness in the Underdark. Chris Perkins even stated, I was a reminder of Alice in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass. That's when I decided that our Underdark tale was going to draw inspiration from Lewis Carroll's work. I was just wondering what others thought on this, if you have found any more characters that are heavily influenced to remind you of Lewis's work. Says Shane, great video. Thanks, Michael. I appreciate that. What I responded, I said, Droki is the only character I see as a direct analog of a Lewis Carroll character, you know, the White Rabbit. I think everything else is just kind of represents kind of the oddness and the feel, the kind of surreal nature of Alice in Wonderland, if Alice in Wonderland had demon madness permeating it. You know, the Pudding King and all that. And, of course, the bigwigs and the pygmy warts are direct, you know, drink me to grow big or eat me to grow small or whatever it is in the book. So, you know, what he's referring to is Chris Perkins, who was one of the main designers of this adventure from D&D, said that it's kind of influenced by Alice in Wonderland. So what Michael is asking, has anybody else out there noticed characters that are sort of direct representations of Alice in Wonderland characters such as Droki being the White Rabbit, which the Droki is obviously a White Rabbit, you know, type character. Oh, I'm late, always running, and you're trying to trace him down and all that stuff. So, and then, you know, he mentioned that he feels that the Ilvara is a Queen of Hearts type. I hadn't made that connection myself, but sure, why not? So, love to have your thoughts out there on that. Andersrolig, and this is, I will post this also in the show notes, but you can go to the comments on episode 46, and he posted an Out of the Abyss guide from elventower.com, and it's very good. It's a good sort of DM's guide on each chapter of Out of the Abyss, and you know, I think that a couple of chapters that can get difficult to run, they don't necessarily have to be difficult, but can get so far, have been Gracklestug and Blindingstone, because there's a lot of different moving parts, especially Gracklestug, man. There's so much stuff going on there. And then also, you know, Blindingstone to an extent as well, all the different NPCs and factions and this and that and possible quests, and it does a good job of helping you wade through all that. So yeah, I'll definitely post a link to this in the show notes. It's elventower.com, Out of the Abyss Guide. Thanks so much, Anders, for that. That's super helpful. I'm going to be using it, and I want to make sure everybody else knows about it, too. And then Rob Plummer followed up on, we've been talking about Liaman's tiny hut, and he had said that, you know, since it's magic, when you're inside of it, it's kind of bigger than what you would think. And I said, well, I don't see that in the rules. You know, so I asked, is that somewhere else? And, you know, no offense, I'm just kind of trying to flesh this out. And he said, hey, no offense, taking it all, Shane. Appreciate that, Rob. Appreciate we can hash out stuff and nobody takes it personally. That's definitely the way I want things around here. You know, we can say, oh, I'm not sure. Let's look at that deeper. And you know, people don't go, why? How can you possibly question me? So he said, rules as written does not say it expands magically. I can't remember where I saw someone else had thoughts similar to mine. But in any case, it's however the DM wants to play it. Sure enough. So if Rob or another player who's DMing the game or whatever wants to say, when you get inside Liaman's tiny hut, that it feels bigger than that 10-foot circumference dome, fair enough. So I think that is all of the feedback for episode 46. I appreciate everybody writing in. I like to get your feedback. I love to get comments and thumbs up on the videos because, you know, it's one of the things that encourages me to keep doing these kind of videos. So anyway, really appreciate you guys for that. All right, so that's viewer feedback. I'm going to take off my +3 glasses of viewer feedback, and we'll go more into what happened in the session. Well, as I said, the session went a little bit off the rails. I don't go off the rails very often, but I think it's okay every now and then within reason. And this past Tuesday, it turned out to be fun. You know, it could have gone a couple of different ways, but it turned out to be fun. And so it's okay to get a little goofy every now and then. As long as everybody seems like they're having fun. You don't want to be doing it if half the party is, like, you know, upset. Or if even one person's really upset, you know, because they're there to play the game that you're playing, right? So I'll explain what I mean. We got there, and one of the players had some little Velociraptor minis. And they're like, hey, this is my character's new pets. And they were just joking around. And then we had a discussion on, you know, Velociraptors, as we know Velociraptors in the Jurassic Park movies, aren't really Velociraptors. Those are something else. Velociraptors are actually these shorter chicken-looking dinosaurs. But anyway. We had a little side discussion, as geeks will, on that. And then we got to talk about dinosaurs in the Underdark. I said, well, probably don't have to worry too much about running into dinosaurs in the Underdark. And then the players were like, well, there could be dinosaurs down here. We could have a T-Rex down here. It could be kind of wedged in the tunnel or something like that. And so this went on for a little while. And I went, okay, all right. I said, fine. The wall busts open and a big T-Rex charges in. And they're like, eh? And so what I did is I sicked a T-Rex on them. And one of the players had a really great 4th edition mini of a T-Rex. I'll put some pictures of it in. But we basically said this is a dream. We're just having fun. This, what happens here, is not going to affect the real game, because obviously a T-Rex isn't busting in. But so let's just do it for the fun of it. And everyone's like, okay. So we had a T-Rex fight. T-Rexes, as written, are actually, they're CR8 monsters, and they're pretty tough. It does a lot of damage with its bite. It does a lot of damage with its tail, and it moves quickly. So, I think it gets like 50 feet of movement. They're nasty. And it did, I think it dropped the monk. I basically have a monk who's a Jedi because he's a monk. He's a fifth level monk with a sun sword, the Dawnbringer from Out of the Abyss, the Sunblade. He's basically a Jedi and he's gotten really tough. So, the T-Rex managed to knock him unconscious, even though, one of the healers got him back up. So the thing with T-Rexes are, they have a lot of hit points, and they get a multi-attack, they get a bite attack, and they get a tail attack, and they move quickly. But they've got a fairly low armor class at AC 13, so they're so big and all that. They're fairly easy to hit, so you can do a lot of damage to them quickly. So I think it lasted 3 or 4 rounds. T-Rex did some damage, and they got knocked down, showing again that this group is pretty powerful, as discussed. I think Rob Plummer had pointed out before, hey man, your group's pretty powerful. You may want to adjust your encounters. Just further proof of that. Something I'd already been tinkering around with. So, and that was another reason I did this. One, it was fun, and the party had fun. I said, is everyone cool with this? Like, yeah. So we just had fun with it. Just had this sort of weird combat at the beginning of the session, and but it was also, I was like, hey, let me see if I can drop a big creature on them and see what happens. And my cats are fighting over here. I guess they wanted to accentuate the creature attack. So there was, they dropped it pretty quick, but it was kind of also showed the party that look, you can still be killed, because I mean this T-Rex rolled in and did some damage. So damage. So that's, I guess it was a French T-Rex. I don't know. And another thing, it was kind of funny. I'll put a picture of this up too. The blind rogue, he stated he immediately knew it was a dream because he could see, which I thought was kind of funny role playing. And he just walked off and sat down and started eating a sandwich and watching the fight. And everyone was like, but I said, look, guys, none of this carries over. There was my cat's tail. I don't know. Come here, Bonnie. You want to say hi to everybody? Bonnie, come here. You're going to see Bonnie. Come here, Bonnie. Oh, goodness. Oh, you're so terrible. You don't want to say hi to everybody? Bonnie doesn't want to say hi. Bonnie decided not to say hi. She's usually more laid back in that. So anyway, that's a stealth cat. She rolled a high stealth. So anyway, it was fun and everybody had a good time with it. But I said, look, none of this carries over to the real game. So you can't be like given, daggers, the blind rogue. You can't be like giving him a hard time for not helping in the fight. And another thing, I shouldn't have said it was a dream. I should have let him kind of curious what was going on because the mage used ice knife spell, the ice knife spell, which I'm pretty sure is from the elemental Princes of the Apocalypse source book or extra PDF or something like that. I don't think it's one of the main spells, but it does an initial damage and then it explodes and does damage in an area. And the mage was wantonly hurting other characters to hurt the T-Rex, knowing that it was a dream. So, I wish they would have played it a little bit more like this is serious, but hey, it was just kind of a goofy off the rails and everybody had a good time. And we learned a little bit about it too. It helped me as a DM to know more about the capabilities of the party. So we just had fun with that. The one guy was like, well, I think there could be a T-Rex down here. And I was like, oh yeah, you think so? Okay, T-Rex time. And everyone was like, because there's big Minnie was like, bam, dropped on the map. So we had a good time with that. And that was the first off the rails. The second off the rails came later in the session. So what they did was, Nomi had summoned an elemental. So it was Nomi in the in Entomox Boon, and then Trist Adamantlepiece, the Burrow Wardens, the young impressionable youth who's studying under Burrow Warden Jadger the Ghost to reestablish the Burrow Wardens, was there with her. They had summoned an elemental. And the party was like, we need to get back to Blingdenstone because there's a big battle about to happen. And one of the main reasons we're here is to get ready for that battle. But I think they ended up doing like 2 long rests to give Nomi time to summon a couple more elementals so that she could, and her and Triss could be safe. And then, you know, the crew's like, okay, we're getting back, and, you know, you guys need to get back pretty soon because, you know, the battle's going to happen and they're going to need these elementals, kind of thing. But Nomi was, like, still studying and, you know, and summoning elementals and all this stuff. So, but they wanted to make sure they had enough protection with them before they left them at Entomog's Moon. So they decided to hoof it as quickly as possible back to Blindenstone. Now, this brought up fast travel and forced march. They were like, can we travel double speed? Can we do this? Can we do a forced march? Da, da, da. So we looked this stuff up, and, you know, I'm going to share this just in case it's interesting to anybody. First of all, there's travel pace, okay? And travel pace, in regular player's handbook, page 181 and 182, There's fast, normal, and slow to how fast you can travel. Fast is like 30 miles a day. Normal is 24 miles a day. Slow is 18 miles a day, et cetera. And then it goes down to hour and minute. Now, in the Underdark, there's a different travel pace. And this is on page 18. This in the Underdark and Out of the Abyss, it supersedes that one in the player's handbook. And it's 8 miles per day is fast, 6 miles per day is normal, and 4 miles per day is slow. And if you're going fast, you get like a -5 penalty to passive wisdom perception scores. You can't forage. If you're going slow, you can be stealthy while you move, and you can also get improved foraging and that sort of thing. So keep in mind, in the Underdark, there's a different travel pace because the Underdark is harder to travel through. But a forced march does not mean you travel as double your normal speed or anything like that. It's not like a dash on a day's movement worth, and, you know, instead of a round's worth of movement. What a forced march does, this is on page 181 in the player's handbook. It says the travel pace table assumes the characters travel for 8 hours a day. They can push on beyond that limit at the risk of exhaustion. So for each additional hour of travel beyond 8 hours, the characters cover the distance shown in the hour column for their pace, and each character must make a constitution saving throw at the end of the hour. The DC is 10, plus 1 for each hour past 8 hours. On a failed saving throw, a character suffers 1 level exhaustion. And then see Appendix A for exhaustion. Exhaustion is anywhere from disadvantage or, you know, on ability or combat checks, just messes with your movement. And then finally, if you get enough exhaustion, 6 levels, you can die. So just keep that in mind, that there are forced march rules, but it doesn't necessarily double your pace. It's just on the player's handbook travel table, there's an hour and a minute distance traveled for fast, average, or slow, fast, normal, or slow, just like there's a day. And for each hour you force march, then you can go that many more under the hour column. And then, but you also have to roll to see a constitution check to see if you get exhaustion or not. So that's how force march works. So just in case you're wondering. Now, they were like, really, you know, which was good because, you know, evidently I'd really set the tone as a DM that, like, this battle's about to happen and y'all need to get back. As a DM, I knew when they got back, they got back. And then things would kick off from there, unless for some reason they were like, we're just going to stay at Interlock Spoon for like a month, you know, or something like that. They didn't know that, though. They were like, we got to get back. So they like boom, 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 and they traveled. I think they just did normal travel. They didn't do force march or anything like that. And because some of them got exhaustion already for not sleeping well in the Underdark. If you remember, I've got a house rule, which I got somebody else, man. I wish I could remember read that to give them credit, but, you know, every time they do a long rest, there's a certain percentage, if they roll that or less, they don't get the benefits of a long rest. And if they start failing more than a row, they start getting levels of exhaustion. And we do have characters that have not gotten their hit points back or have not gotten their spells back and have started accumulating exhaustion from that. And right now it's at 20%, and that seems to be hitting pretty often. So I don't think I'm going to jack it up to 30% unless after the Battle of Blindenstone they decide to lollygag and not leave. Because one of the reasons I'm doing is to reinforce it's really nasty down here. There's demon madness. You're not sleeping well. This is bad. You need to get out. Because I don't think, I really don't think that the adventure, after the initial point that, like, look, you got captured by the drow and you escaped the drow, there's not really a whole lot in the adventure that's like, you need to get back to the surface, you need to get back to the surface, you need to get back. There's a lot of, oh, this is interesting over here, and this is interesting over here, and oh, let's look at that. And there's this sort of, you know, hey, how do we get to the surface kind of thing. But, you know, it's you could easily be like, ooh, shiny, and they're off quest after quest after quest after quest and not heading up. And like I said, the first part of the adventure, now you could change it up if you wanted. You could, you know, change the flavor. That's fine. You can DM it how you want. But if you follow the book as written, which I, for the most part, do, you know, the first part of the adventure is very, you know, grim and survival horror, and we're trying to get out of here for the most part. Although, after a while, they get a little bit more powerful in it, especially in this group's case, because I have like 8 players, you know, and it starts becoming more like action horror rather than survival horror. But I still want them to go up to the top so we can, you know, have that break in between part one and part two, and then set a different tone for when they come back down. And they can have different characters and all that, you know, mount an expedition rather than having been sucked down into the other dark against their will. So anyway, they booked it back. I didn't do any encounter rolls. You know, I purposely did not have any random encounters on their way back. But, you know, they were doing long rests and this and that, and Liam and Tiny Hut, and, you know, and we role played through the traveling back. And then once they got into what's called Outer Blingdenstone, which is kind of rural Blingdenstone, and it's, I'm trying to think how to put it. It's just like a lot of caves and this and that. It's not like Blingdenstone proper, but there's like mines, and there's the Stoneheart Quarry, and there's some other stuff. It's almost like the rural farm area around a major city. And you know, I think the book even kind of describes it that way a little bit. So they on their own, they were like, hey, we need to stop and talk to the Stoneheart Quarry, right? The Stoneheart Enclave that's at the quarry. And the Stoneheart Enclave is the guild of magicians and clerics and stuff that study the elementals and take care of all that for Blingdenstone, because elementals are very important to the culture and economy of Blingdenstone. So on their own, they stop there, and the head of the enclave, it was Nomi's the second command. You know, Nomi's still, you know, at the Intimox Moon, but I can't remember her name. Let me see if I can find it. The main lady who runs the whole show, she was there. I said she was there. And, yeah, here we go. Let's see if I can find it. La, la, la. Yeah, it's probably not that important, but I've already spent this much time on it, so I'll see if I can find it. Yeah, Yantha Cokesrock. Normally, Yantha Cokesrock leads the operations in the quarry. While she is somewhere else, her apprentice, Nomi Pathshutter, is in charge. So Yantha was like, whoa, hey, what news do you have? Because the characters have been gone, like, well over a week. And people knew that it was 2 days there and 2 days back. So they were kind of starting to wonder, you know, what's going on. And, you know, the characters are like, well, it really was hard to find this. And it was. I mean, I spoke about that in a previous video. It's extremely difficult to find Intimox Moon by the rules. And, in fact, I had to make it easier. And they still had a hard time finding it. It varies like multiple DC 20 group check rolls to find it. Just kind of crazy. But anyway, you know, long story short, they say, well, you know, Nomi is still there. We found it. Here's how to find it. She's making stone elementals. She's coming this way. And Yantha's like, whoa, okay. And then she immediately starts putting together a group of people to go relieve Nomi and bring Nomi and the elemental she's already made back. So that was a nice little role-playing moment that, you know, wasn't written into the adventure, but, you know, the bard player, ironically enough, is also sort of the spokesman for the group. And, you know, just naturally that the person playing the bard has that natural kind of, I'm the leader, you know, not in a rude kind of way, just has that personality. And so, well, we need to go tell them what's going on. So they stop by there, and then they come back to Blingdenstone. And this, none of this is written in the book. This is just stuff you DM, you know, as you're making up as you go along. And there's, like, they show up at the main gates, and there's people, like, they've been looking for them, like, you know, grabbing other guards. Oh, they're here. And escort them right to the Digermatox, where the big war council is still going on. And so, you know, they kind of fill everybody in on what's happening. The elementals seem better, and there should be more soon on the way. And then the Digermatox and everybody else that's kind of at Digermatox Hall, you know, the were-rats and the city guard and the borough warden and the clerics and all that, you know, there's still a lot of activity. There's maps and there's this and there's battle plans and da-da-da-da. And they say, okay, well, you know, we will wait till the first round of elementals gets here, and then we're going in. And they kind of tell them what the plan is. And they say, here's the plan we came up with. And this is straight out of the book. There's a battle plan that they come up with for the Battle of Blingdenstone, as it were. And during just a couple of role-playing notes, during the while they're, you know, giving a download to Dorbo, Digermatox, I think that's his name. It's his wife. Is it Dorbo and Cinny? Yeah, Dorbo and everybody else, and his wife Cinny. I think that's her name. Yeah, Cinny. They're kind of giving a download. And they had, if you'll remember last video, they had found some basilisk's eggs. And then they had taken 3 or 4 eggs, and they're going to keep one for themselves and try to hatch it, and they're going to give the others to the borough wardens, so the borough wardens can use that as even more leverage to establish their credibility in Blingdenstone. I guess they like borough warden Jadger, I guess, and sympathize with his cause. Well, one of the players starts mentioning these eggs while they're kind of filling Dorbo, Digermatox, and Cinny, Digermatox, and the clerics, and the war chiefs, and Chipgrin, and the were-rats, and all this stuff. And everyone's like, you know, like, shut up. But Dorbo heard eggs. And so I decided to have a kind of fun moment with it. And he's like, eggs? Oh, you're hungry. I'm a terrible host. I'm so sorry. I was, you know, we were worried about you. You were gone well beyond the time that we thought you would be. He's like, you would like eggs? What kind of eggs would you like? Eggs for our guests. So, and they're like, well, scrambled eggs and egg sandwiches and da da da. So we just had a fun moment with eggs for the guests. Eggs for our guests was kind of the, you know, the big thing. So Dorbo orders eggs for everybody. And so that was a nice role-playing moment that came out of a moment when, and I kind of did a purpose, because the player who brought up the egg, everyone's like, what? Shut up! You know, and I didn't want that player to feel bad. So I kind of made a funny moment out of it. Because he didn't really know. And sometimes you have discussions. You have 8 people at a table. It's easy to have discussions that somebody isn't privy to or didn't pay attention to. So he may not have been aware that they were trying to keep the eggs on the down low. And then one of my players, he's always got a tablet on him, and he's got all these memes, D&D and RPG-related memes. And somehow he had a meme showing that, you know, a chicken laying an egg, and the egg was called a butt nugget. So we had fun with that. The mistranslation between common and gnomish was that Dorbo, butt nuggets for everybody, butt nugget sandwiches and butt nugget and boiled buck nuggets and scrambled butt nuggets. So that was pretty funny. So every time you have an egg from now on, think of a butt nugget. Courtesy Shane Plays and the Out of the Abyss group. So butt nuggets for everybody. Now, basically what they've been told was that the were-rats, because the were-rat tunnels, you have to go through there to get to where the Pudding King's Pudding Army is growing, and, you know, to really see how bad it is. And, you know, basically, so the were-rats have been keeping an eye on the ooze situation, and it's getting worse. It's getting worse. It's getting very bad. So, you know, kind of trying to keep the sense of tension there. But also trying to give a couple of days, because I want the, you know, I kind of DM'd myself into a corner by saying, well, Nomi wants to keep practicing raising elementals. Was like, but they need those elementals for the fight. So I kind of DM'd myself into a corner, and I had to fudge that, you know, we got to wait 2 or 3 more days for this first wave of elementals to come in. And the battle plan that shared with the characters were fine with, you know, if you're running this, adventure. Your party may not be okay with it, but this is the plan that was presented to the players. They said, this is what we've come up with while you've been gone. And the players are like, yeah, sure, sounds good to us. So it says, this is under Cry Havoc, page 114. On Out of the Abyss, and it says, when the characters feel they have attained their goals and secure the resources, the battle for Blingdenstone can begin. So this is what's going to happen very soon, basically at the beginning of next session. Earth Elementals under the control of the Stoneheart Enclave lead the charge, followed by the Were-Rats of Clan Goldwhisker. Sverf Neblum under Chief Dorbo Diggermatok form the rear guard and provide range support. If the ghosts participate, which they will, because they established a good relationship with Borough Warden Jadger and they did the quest related to the ghost, they'll attack from above and below. So the plan is all the other factions are going to confront the majority of the oozes and keep them at bay. And then the characters, their goal is they want to get the characters to the Pudding King, almost like a special forces group getting to take out the Pudding King while everybody else is fighting the main faction. So that's, and there's more to it, which we'll get into next video once the Battle of Blingdenstone actually unfolds, what the characters are going to have to go through. But that's the plan that's presented. They're like, we're cool with it. And, you know, everybody tells the characters, hey, you're welcome to hang out here as we continue to make plans. Or if you want to go rest or whatever you want to do or prepare. But, you know, within approximately 2 days we'll begin. You know, they're going to wait for some elementals to show up, the tougher elementals from Entomox Moon, which really, by the rules, they're not that much tougher. But role-playing wise, I'm going to play them that they're tough. They're much tougher. I'll see if I can find that, because I don't think I've talked about that yet, what Entomox Moon does. If the circle is used to cast a spell that summons an earth elemental, this is an Entomox Boon. This is on page 100 of Out of the Abyss. The spell's duration becomes 1d4 plus 6 days. 1d4 plus 6, and the spell requires no concentration. The summoned elemental never becomes hostile toward the spell's caster or its companions. So, and then it goes in the benefits. So they just stick around longer, and it doesn't require concentration to keep the elemental there. But for this, I'm just kind of role-playing that they're tougher. And I'm probably going to give the players at least one. I think the battle plan, at least in the book, if I remember right, sends an elemental with the players. And I'm going to give them kind of a beefier one. And they have a stone, I think, where they can summon an elemental, if I remember right, that they already have as a previous quest reward. So that was kind of what happened the last session, except for, oh my goodness, talking about off the rails. Okay, so the players are like, okay, we're going to go to Trader's Grotto and look for merchants because we want to buy stuff. And they're, you know, I can't remember what they wanted now. I know one player is always looking for a Book of Abyssal because he's wanting to learn Abyssal, and I let him roll for that. I think I gave him 30% chance. He didn't find it. I'm a big fan of just assigning a percentage chance if it's an unusual request and saying, well, let's see if they have it or not. That's just how I do it. That's my style. You know, other people could say yes, they have it, or no, they don't. But I like that kind of knuckle-biting drama of, well, let's see. And it kind of simulates, you know, you're searching all these racks and bookshelves, and is it really there? And then and there's a chance, there it is, I found it. So that's just kind of how I do it. And a lot of times in a fight, if there's like one enemy and multiple opponents, you know, if there's one monster attacking several group members, I'll roll randomly to determine who it attacks. That's just how I've always done it. Now, other people might be different, and that's fine, but that's just how I do it. So they were looking for some stuff, and he was trying to find a vendor because they had the ink, the Roctopus's ink sack, and they had a they had the basilisk stomach that they had gotten from the previous couple of sessions. And he was looking for somebody to sell those to, and he found a merchant that was like, yeah, I'll take that. And he was like, well, what can you give me? And they were kind of haggling. And, you know, I was looking in the book. I didn't have enough time, you know, to figure out, because I didn't want to put a halt on the game and then go dig into the Dungeon Master's Guide. I got to do a better job of knowing off the top of my head or exactly where to find, like a potion of greater healing, how much does that cost, right? What's the exact gold piece value? And so, you know, because there's all these tables and charts and this and that and the other in the Dungeon Master's Guide. And I was kind of flipping and looking. I finally just said, look, he'll give you like 3 potions of greater healing for the Basilisk Stomach and the Rock Puss Ink Sack. And they're like, okay, that sounds good. And then one of my characters said, does he have a deck of many things? Now, before I go any further, the deck of many things is one of my favorite magic items ever. I love the sheer knuckle-biting, random, either amazing or awful things that can happen, and very powerful stuff. I love it. The deck of many things, even since way back in like in the 80s, has been one of my favorite magic items. Okay? But it's also very chaotic and can be upsetting to game balance and to party balance. Okay, it should not be used lightly. And I really feel that it should be planned for. It shouldn't just be some random thing. Having said all that, you know, I was like, okay, if I roll a 1 on percentage dice, then yeah, he's got a deck of many things. I'm like, I'm not going to roll a 1, right? I'm just giving the slimmest, smallest possible chance. Rolled it. And it rolled on the other side of the DM screen, and I didn't even really see what the result was. And I saw blue dice, and it was like a blue. Another, I said the blue dice is the you know, the ones, and the other dice is the tens or whatever. And I had seen that the blue rolled a 0, and I was like, huh. And then like a bunch of the players were like, oh, and I thought they were messing with me. And so I look over the DM screen, and I'd rolled a flipping 1. And they said that, like, I went over this DM screen like this, and I was like, I mean, like, they said, I was like, I kind of remember it, but I kind of don't. I mean, I remember looking, but it seemed like I looked at it for a while, and they said it, I was kind of like this, you know, like, for like a minute or something. Like, my son's downstairs yelling. He's accentuating the drama in the moment. I was like, so, now, I'm not going to go back on my word. I said, if I roll a 1, he has a deck of many things. Now, I'm thinking, whoa, what are we going to do here? This could get bad. There's no way I'm going to let him get an entire deck of many things, because it's like a legendary item, and, it's like 50,000 gold. It's really expensive. So, there's no way I'm going to let him just have a deck of many things, not to mention the fact that I can't afford it. But, I did say if I roll a 1, you get a... He's got a deck of many things. So I had to stop for a second and think really quickly on my feet after the first minute of, like Cam from Ferris Bueller's Day Off when he went catatonic. I was like, there was like slow motion. The hall was stretching like in a dream, even though we weren't in a hallway. You know what I mean? But I'm not going to go back on my word. I said if I roll a 1. Oh, dang it. So I said, okay. He basically, and in retrospect, I should have made it more expensive. But what I ended up doing, long story short, they haggled this and that and the other. And he said, if you'll give me this Basilisk Stomach, and if you'll give me this Roctopus Ink Sack, which are pretty rare, and you give back I'm not going to give you the Potions of Greater Healing, then I will let a few people pull it at 500 gold pieces a pull. In retrospect, I should have said 1,000, because this is pretty big stuff. But 500, still no small potatoes. Plus, they had to trade over those rare things they had harvested from items. Plus, they didn't get their Potions of Greater Healing. I think I ended up selling those. I think I just ended up, at the end of the session, you know, 100 gold pieces each. You can have... So I think they bought 3 Potions of Greater Healing or something. I didn't have time to look it up. We're already running out of time. I need to get better at that. But anyway, so, and, you know, I had to role play it like he got real quiet. And he's like, who have you been talking to? And it just so happens that this guy has a deck of many things that he somehow came into. And he'll let people pull on it for 500 gold pieces a pull, but he doesn't want to get around. They just happen by pure happenstance to stumble across this. It's like accidentally saying, I don't know if you can hear my son down there, but he's adding all kinds of dramatic atmosphere to the story. He's like, which is what can happen with a deck of many things. So it just so happened. It's like, you know, you get challenged for the secret password and you say, you know, monkey knuckles. And it just so happened that's the right path. You know, it's just some just wild coincidence. They happen to ask and he happened to have one. He's like, who are you talking to? But anyway, but the merchant wanted the basilisk stomach and he wanted that Roctopus ink sack. He was very interested in that. That's how I role played it anyway. So anyway, and then what I did, because I'm not going to let 8 players all pull from the deck of many things, because something terrible is going to happen that's going to upset game balance or party balance. Somebody's going to lose a character or something. Something bad, in addition to other good stuff that could happen. So for game balance, and just sheer, they haven't earned it. They haven't earned it. They haven't earned a deck of many things. You know what I mean? I mean, that's a big deal. So what I did was, I said that I said I'm going to roll a 1d4. And what I roll on that is how many times he will let people pull from the card, the deck. Because he's, you know, that's just what I did. And plus, he doesn't want all kinds of craziness going on to bring attention to him with his deck of many things. He makes a little money off of it, you know, everywhere he goes. That's how I came up with it on the moment anyway. So I think like 4 or 5 players wanted to pull from it, and I rolled a 2. I said, 2 of y'all can do it. And they did the old-fashioned, this was like old-school first edition D&D. They didn't negotiate it. They went to dice, and they rolled. And the 2 that rolled the best, I think there was even a tie and they had to have a re-roll, were the ones that got to do it. So they pulled. And they both got pretty good results. And I said, okay. So I said, I'm going to roll one more time. I'm going to roll percentile dice. If I get a 50% or less, one more person can roll. And I did, and I rolled like a 30-something. So I said, one more person can roll. And I think they did another roll-off between the remaining people that wanted to do it, and that person pulled. And it just so happened to work out that everybody got positive stuff. So I felt good about that. Like, it went off the rails, but not in such a way that somebody lost a character or something really. Because you can, like, have your soul banished, or you can be trapped in the abyss. I mean, you can have a devil become your nemesis and chase you around. I mean, you can have all kinds of crazy stuff happen in addition to the good stuff that can happen with a deck of many things. So basically, you know, the party had to pay for its healing potions. They lost a couple of unique scavenged monster organs, and then they paid 1500 gold pieces, and they each got to, and 3 cards got pulled. And I mean, we did the thing, like, somebody, I went looking around the game store, because there at one time the game store had that we play at had an actual deck of many things. I think it was from 4th edition or something. We looked around for that and they didn't have it. Another player pulled out an actual deck of cards, and so we use that. That's the best way to do it if you don't have an actual deck of many things prop, like that you bought from Wizards of the Coast or something. And you actually build it. This is on page 162 of the Dungeon Master's Guide. You build the deck of many things with playing cards, and it's either got most of these decks only have 13 cards, but the rest have 22. And it's a 75% chance that you only have 13 cards. And I actually rolled that, and they rolled under 75. So they should have only got 13 cards. But I was like, if we're going to do this, we're going to do it. So, you know, I gave them the full 22 cards. That was just a spur-of-the-moment decision. To protect them, I should have gone with a 13. But I was like, if we're going to go for the chaotic, you know, knuckle-biting drama of it all, let's at least, you know, go with the full deck. So I did that. And you build it with, you know, regular card, like Ace of Spades, King of Hearts, a couple of Jokers, you know, with the TM. And it's important to know with and without TM, because the Jokers that I used didn't have the trademark symbol on them. One was just bigger than the other one. And I said, well, the the one that's smaller has the without the TM, and that ended up being very important, and I decided that before the game. So we did that. We, you know, I constructed a deck of many things, 22 cards, shuffled it up, had players cut it, oh, the whole thing, and then went player by player and, you know, fanned them out, and they picked out a card. And they got fortunate. They got extremely fortunate. The first thing that was pulled was the Vizier. And the Vizier is that any time you choose within 1 year of drawing this card, you can ask a question in meditation and mentally receive a truthful answer to that question. Besides information, the answer helps you solve a puzzling problem or other dilemma. In other words, the knowledge comes with wisdom on how to apply it. So that was the first pull. Not bad. Second pull was the Star. And the Star is increase one of your ability scores by 2. The score can exceed 20, but can't exceed 24. Again, that's pretty good. And then the last one pulled, I'm like, oh man, you know, because this is, I'm cutting it here. I'm like, nobody pulls after this. You know, and I let this additional pull at the last minute. So if I roll 50% or less, one more person could pull. And they got a Joker. Now, a Joker can be really bad or really good. And they got the Joker without the trademark, which is the Jester, and instead of the Fool. And the Jester, let me find it here. The Jester, you gain 10,000 experience points. Or you can draw 2 additional cards beyond your declared draws. No, the way that a deck of many things normally works. Normally, you have the deck and you say, I'm gonna pull. You have to state how many times you're gonna pull before you do, and then you draw that many. And then some cards say, well, you lose your draws or you get additional draws or whatever. But this player said, well, I'm not gonna draw anymore. I want the 10,000 XP, and that was our mage actually, and it bumped them up a level. And now that I actually saw the player today at church. They're like, I've got Fireball now, and they're all excited. So. They got fortunate because that could have gotten really bad. And I'm like, woo, huh. But that felt so epic. That felt like old school epic D&D, like just out of the blue. I'm going to roll a, okay, you got a 1%. Deck of many flipping things. I mean, yikes. So cool. It worked out really good. But you could have had people getting banished. You could have had people, really horrible things happen. So I'm glad for my players that the ones that got to pull, you know, it worked out well for them. And then I'm like, okay, that's it. And the merchant is actually like packing up to get out of there because I guess he doesn't like to draw too much attention to himself. So he's like, okay, I've made money. I'm here. I'm gone. I got these items. These are cool. I'm out of here. So, you know, I kind of played it up on that, you know, that he's like, okay, got to go, you know, on the deck of many things has been used. It's time for me to go. So, because it's it's even though it's not listed as an artifact, I mean, it's pretty much an artifact level item. It's listed as a wondrous item, legendary. In my opinion, it should be kind of an artifact. But I guess the reason it's not an artifact is because I think there can only be one of any given artifact. And, you know, there's more than one deck of many things, but they're pretty powerful. And they're very chaotic. I love the feeling of it. I love deck of many things. It's like one of my favorite magic items ever. And I've never actually gotten a DM one. So I thought that was great. But anyway, and I also liked the fact, you know, I don't subscribe to this notion that everybody should get everything they want all the time. So I like the fact that there were multiple players that wanted to pull and not everybody got to. Because it's not like they went on a quest to earn this or something. Now, if they got on a quest to find the deck of many things and all that have been different. But just randomly finding it in a merchant who's charging for pulls, no, I'm not going to let the whole party. I'm sorry. And so that feels a little OSR, old school gaming rules, old school first. It just felt a little bit like that for me, and I like that. So, and I don't feel that my players were upset because they saw it was handled fairly. Everybody had an equal chance. So I didn't get the sense either from people's faces or attitudes or anybody feedback that they were really upset about that. They're just like, ah, but they loved everybody loved the moment of it. They were like, oh, everybody was so excited. It was really cool. There's a lot of energy at the table. So anyway, that was the off the rails edition of Shane Plays Out of the Abyss between the T-Rex and the deck of many things. So I guess the T-Rex was me pulling a T-Rex card from the deck of many things and sicking it on them. But anyway, thanks so much for watching. I appreciate your questions. Please leave me any questions, comments you have. Leave the video a thumbs up on YouTube. That helps me out a lot. And if you haven't subscribed, please do so. You know, there's a lot of content like this and other D&D and role-playing game content. I share my live Geek Talk radio show over the air, 96.5 FM, The Answer, out of Little Rock radio show. This weekend I had Neil Adams, comics legend Neil Adams, was on the show. And next week I've got Ed Greenwood. That's right, Ed Greenwood of the Forgotten Realms. So anyway, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. I really appreciate that. And yeah, I think that's everything that I wanted to go over. So that's it for this week, and we will catch you next time on Chain Place. Thanks for watching.